right, in this video, we're going to look at the Goldman-Hodgkins-Katz equation, or the GHK equation, and how it is used as a tool to estimate membrane potential, or VM. And we want to make note of that approximately equal to sign here, because the GHK equation does not include all of the factors that determine membrane potential. It just includes the major ones. So we can actually point out a few of the other things as well. Now let's take a walk through this equation and see what we're including, as well as what's not included, so that we can, you know, make note of those things as well. Now, so Vm is approximately equal to a couple of constants, gas constant over the Faraday constant, and we've got our absolute temperature in there. And all of those are going to be fairly constant in a constant in a physiological setting, especially in homeotherms that tend to maintain a fairly consistent body temperature. Now, we get to the bulk of the equation over here on the right, and we can see that each ion is included that has a significant concentration gradient inside to outside or outside to inside, shown over here on the right, as well as a significant permeability. If either of those two things is zero, in other words, if the gradient is zero, we're multiplying by zero, and of course we could leave it out. If the permeability were zero, we would also be multiplying by zero. So what this means is that an individual ion contributes more to the membrane potential when it has both a large gradient and a high permeability. And what we find is that potassium tends to be the ion that has the highest permeability and a large gradient in resting cells, at least. Notice that we also include sodium and also include chloride in this equation. And you might ask, why don't we include another ion like calcium or bicarbonate or any other ion? And the reason typically is that they tend to have a very low resting permeability. And again, we'd be multiplying by them by zero, so we can just leave them out. Some people even leave chloride out of the equation because it actually tends to be very close to equilibrium, its own equilibrium, when a cell is at rest. Now, another thing to point out is that our chloride concentrations are actually flip-flopped relative to the cations, right? Those are out over in for both of them, whereas chloride is in over out. And that simply compensates for the fact that this is an anion, right? We want it to affect the answer in the manner in which it actually would affect the answer. And to do so, we have to just sort of flip-flop our gradients to get it to accurately reflect reality. Now we see what's in the equation. What's missing from the equation? Well, we certainly don't see the sodium-potassium pump. And we know that that pump is called electrogenic for a reason, right? It tends to move three sodium ions out and only two potassium in. That's a net movement of charge, right? One positive charge out, tending to make the inside of the cell negative. We should not infer that that's a significant component. Again, Goldman, Hodgkin, and Katz did not include it in their equation because it only contributes a very minor component. Now, it's a huge part of setting up the gradients of sodium high outside and low inside, and potassium high inside and low outside. So it is important, it's just not important in terms of its movement of charge. Another thing we don't see is the presence of cytoplasmic proteins that are negatively charged. They do tend to alter the distribution of other permeant charged entities, other ions, but it is relatively insignificant. So again, we can leave it out of the equation here, right? Now, one other thing we want to point to is the fact that membrane potential in some cells, excitable cells, is not fixed. It can change. And so if we change the permeability of a particular ion, we may need to add an ion that's not even shown here. If we increase the permeability to calcium, all of a sudden we should probably include calcium in this equation. Very commonly, cells increase permeability to sodium, excitable cells. And in that case, what's going to happen is sodium is going to contribute much more dramatically to the answer over here. Well, if we look at the equilibrium potential for sodium, where it's at its equilibrium, it's very positive value. And so what's going to happen is sodium will more dramatically pull the answer here toward a positive value, even making the answer positive in some cases, depending upon the contributions of the other ions. So again, it's important to recognize that this is an estimate of membrane potential, as well as that the contributing factors can change, in, at least in some cells, where permeabilities to those ions can vary over time through the opening or closing of gated channels.